Now?
Yes.
Okay, friends, this is Dr. Yamuna KM, Assistant Professor, Department of Chemistry, NSS College, Manjeri. Welcome to the second episode of our weekly webinar series. With me, I have got Bashpa, Smita, Vineet, and our former colleague, Dr. Sindhu Ramachandran here. And happy to all you here. We are having you or welcoming you warmly to this session. And today we have Dr. Sajani to speak on SPM techniques and nanomaterials. And Ms. Bashpa, please, NSS College Manjeri, she will chair the session today. And I invite Bashpa to follow on.
Good afternoon all. Welcome to this session. Here, today's resource person is Dr. Sajani V. I'm very happy to introduce her as she is my classmate also. A few words about her. Dr. Sajani, presently working as a senior executive scientist at the Kevin Care Research Center, Chennai. She has completed her master's degree in applied chemistry from CUSAT and her PhD from the National University of Singapore in 2012. Her work was mainly concentrated on the synthesis and characterization of nanomaterials, carbon nanomaterials, particularly graphene. After that, she has joined as a faculty in the Amrita Institute of Medical and Nanosciences. There also, she mainly worked on the inorganic and organic nanohybrids and energy storage devices. She has 19 publications, 2 book chapters, and also 2 full patents. So we are happy to have you, Sajani, here. So I welcome you to have your session. Thank you.
Thank you, Bashpa, for the nice introduction. So good afternoon, all. Is my slide visible? No.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So let me start. And I thank you once again, Bashpa, for calling me or inviting me to give this lecture. I'm very privileged because as of now, I'm not in touch with your academic research. So it gives me immense pleasure to talk something which I'm really interested in. So basically, in today's session, I'll be discussing about scanning probe microscopic techniques. So to start with, I would like to say what is scanning probe microscope. So basically, they are instruments that are used to study the surface of materials or probe the surface of materials at the nanoscale level. Also, it will allow manipulation of individual atoms or molecules. So basically, if you see scanning probe microscope, you can classify them in generally into 2. One is scanning tunneling microscope and the other one is atomic force microscope, or you call it as AFM. So I will start with scanning tunneling microscopy, or STM as abbreviation. So to start with, what is the basic mechanism to probe the surface using STM is quantum mechanical electron tunneling. And this invention in 1986 won the Nobel Prize for the scientists in IBM Zurich to start with. So here in the picture, you can clearly see like they had deposited xenon atoms on nickel surface, and they have lithographed IBM onto the surface. So that was with the help of this scanning tunneling microscope. So that led to the Nobel Prize. They have won the Nobel Prize for this innovation in STM. So moving on, as I said, the basic principle of STM is electron tunneling. So in simple words, this is how an ideal model of an STM operation will look like, or STM tip will look like. You have a very sharp conductive tip, and then you have your sample surface. So this sharp conductive tip is brought into very close proximity of the surface of the sample. So this distance between the probe and the sample surface plays a critical role. Only when it is very close, you will have the tunneling current happening, or the tunneling of electrons taking place, which is actually monitored, and the topography of the surface is imaged. And While doing this, you apply a bias voltage. So basically what will happen is when the tip is brought into close proximity to the sample surface, electrons start tunneling from one surface to the other of lower potential because of the bias voltage applying. And this tunneling current is measured and that is converted into the topographic image. So basically this is how it happens. So you should have, what are the conditions for this tunneling to happen is that you should have a very small distance or very small gap between the tip as well as the sample surface, and you should have a bias voltage applied for the net current to flow. So these are work function of some of the metals which are used as substrates in the case of STM. So typically, if you see, gold substrates are generally used where the work function is 4.8. So onto the top of this gold substrate or gold substrate, you will be depositing your samples and then allow it to dry. So I have been telling again and again, why do you need a very sharp tip? So basically what is happening is if you have a very blunt tip, in this case, you can see two types of tips. One is a very sharp tip where you have a single atom on the surface of the tip. Whereas in the second one, you can see that this has a few atoms less. But how or what is the impact of this is that in this case of the second tip, the current it carries or the tunneling current which happens through this tip will be a million times less. So what will happen? The resolution of your image will be very poor. So that is why we insist that you should have a single atom at the tip of the tip so that the majority of the current will flow through it and you will have atomic resolution. And there are some essential conditions for the STM to operate and then to get an optimal or a better imaging. First of all, it can work in both liquid as well as air environment, but preferably in an ultra high vacuum condition. So you must be thinking, why do you need an ultra high vacuum environment? Basically, it will prevent any possible surface oxidation which is taking place, and also it will help to maintain a conductive sample surface. One more prerequisite is that it should have a very low temperature. Preferably a low temperature measurement is preferred. Again, the reason for that is that if you have relatively higher temperature, you will have thermal drift as well as diffusion of atoms taking place, which might hinder your imaging. So you may not be able to get a static surface image of atoms. So these are the prerequisite for STM to function. So this is how a typical STM instrument will look like. This is how it will look like. And the image, if you can see, this is actually STM image of HOPG, which is highly oriented pyrolytic graphite. So here you can see this scale is 5 into 5 nanometer. So you can see the hexagonal array of carbon atoms, which you can see as in the case of graphite. So I showed this image to show you that this level of imaging is possible with STM, provided you operate it under optimal conditions. If not, getting a satisfactory image is highly challenging with this instrument. So before we move on, I would like to show some of the works which we have done with STM. So this is actually my work published in Nanoscale in 2011. So in this case, what we have done is we had attempted a covalent functionalization for graphene nanosheets. So what was this objective was to improve the dispersibility. So from reviewers, there were questions like, how do you ensure that the functionalization has taken place? Though we had provided sufficient spectroscopic characterization data to support the claims, they still wanted an imaging tool to prove that. So for that, we had that. So to continue, this image A shows that of image A is that of the graphene sheets prior functionalization or covalent functionalization. So here you can see the regular hexagonal array of carbon atoms, though you can see some areas you have that irregularities. So this was a surfactant wrapped graphene sheet. So these irregularities is mainly because of the loosely bound residual surfactants sitting on the surface. This was CTAB modified graphene sheets. And image B shows the covalently functionalized graphene sheets. So here, if you see the hexagonal array or the hexagonal distribution of carbon atom, it is completely hampered and you have many brighter regions. So these brighter regions are those, like, we can directly attribute it to the presence of the alkyl azides, which are the alkyl groups which we have functionalized onto the graphene surface. So that might have completely hampered the electron density on the surface, and that is why you see many brighter regions in the image. So with the help of this imaging, we could successfully prove that yes, we have achieved the covalent functionalization. So imaging as a tool to prove this was really helpful in publishing this article. So moving on, I will give a bit more detailed explanation about the operational modes of STM. So basic principle is electron tunneling. You can operate this microscope under different modes. So the first two modes are constant current mode and constant height mode. And the third mode is manipulation mode. So as the name suggests, manipulation mode is nothing but you operate it for relocating or removing atoms from a surface or depositing something, some atoms or molecules onto the surface. So that is basically manipulation mode. But mainly for imaging purposes, you will be using either constant current mode or constant height mode. So to moving on, this is the operational principle of STM. So you will have three drives, piezo drives, PX and PY. This PX and PY will scan the surface, will scan the metal tip over the surface in X and Y directions, and you have a piezo drive PZ onto which your tip will be, your metallic tip will be attached to. And then you have a control unit which will apply the necessary voltage to PZ to maintain the constant tunneling current at a bias voltage. So to move on, what is constant current mode of operation? So I will explain it in very simple words. So first you will have a sharp metal tip which is fixed onto the piezo drive PZ. And this PZ, the function of this piezo drive PZ is to control the height or the distance between the sample surface and the tip. And then the tip is brought close enough to the sample surface so that electrons can tunnel through the vacuum barrier between the tip and the sample. So this will happen only if the tip is brought into very close proximity to the sample surface. Then following that, you will be applying a bias voltage onto the sample surface. So when it reaches the suitable proximity, you will have a tunneling current, and this tunneling current can be measured through the tip. So which you know that this is extremely sensitive. So the distance between the tip and the surface is extremely critical for getting a better resolution or getting an atomic resolution. And as I said earlier, the other two piezo drives, PX and PY, are used to scan the tip in two lateral dimensions. And you have a feedback control which will adjust your height of the tip in order to maintain the tunneling current constant. So in the constant current mode of operation, basically the tunneling current is maintained constant. So how do you maintain the tunneling current constant? You will be adjusting the height of the tip in order to get the tunneling current a constant. So during this, the voltage applied to the piezo drive PZ will be recorded, because if you want to change the distance, you will be applying a different voltage to the PZ drive. So during the scanning, this voltage applied to the piezo drive will be recorded, and that will be converted into an image which will represent the topograph of the surface. And the next one is constant height mode of operation. Basically, if you see the principle, there is no fundamental difference, but in this case, what you are doing is you are maintaining a constant height. You are not varying the distance between the tip and the sample surface. On the other hand, here you are measuring the variation in the tunneling current to reflect the atomic corrugations of the surface. But one disadvantage of using this constant height mode of operation is that if you have so much of surface irregularities, the tip could be crushed. So preferably, a constant current mode of operation is preferred if you are not very sure about the surface type. So if you are very sure that your surface is very smooth, in that case you can use constant height mode of operation, because the possibility of having the tip being crashed will be minimal. If not, a constant current mode of operation is preferred. So moving on, as I said, the STM tip is very crucial in getting very good images, because the surface scanning is done by a single atom. So the commercially available STM tips being used are either tungsten metal or platinum iridium alloy tips. And as I said earlier, for STM to work in an efficient manner, you need to have preferably ultra high vacuum, and most of the cases the operations will be done at night, where you will have minimal sound interferences. Similarly, the equipment will be placed in a vibration isolation platform so that the disturbances are minimized. So moving on, commercially these tips are available, but how do you prepare them? Like, once you use, you can still sharpen the tips further. So how do you do that? That is simply an electrochemical reaction. You will use your STM tip or that as the anode, and you will have stainless steel rod as the cathode, and you will use potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide as the electrolyte. So if you are using tungsten as your anode, during the electrochemical reaction, tungstate ions will be formed. And as you can see, like a drop-off mechanism, after a definite time period, it will start dropping off, and ultimately you will end up getting a very sharp tip, which you can see in this SEM image. So basically, the surface of the solvent meniscus or the electrolyte meniscus plays a critical role in getting a sharp tip. So this is how you will be reusing your tip once you purchase. So unless you get a sharp tip, getting a good quality image, as I'm repeating again and again, it will be extremely difficult. Moving on, what are the general applications of STM? As I said earlier, you can do atomic and molecular level manipulation using STM. So how do you do that? First, you can either have a sliding of the STM tip over the surface to move molecules from one end to the other. On the other hand, you can use the same tip to pick up and drop atoms, individual atoms, onto the surface. Here, this image is taken from Science, which is published in 1993, where they have made an atomic coral using iron atoms. So in this picture, you can see that iron atoms are placed on a circular formation, and here the electrons are confined inside the coral. So basically, atomic level of manipulation is possible using STM. Moving on, another application of STM is nanoscale chemical vapor deposition. So, you know, chemical vapor deposition is a technique mainly used for preparing films, metal oxide films, or even carbon-based or carbon nanotubes and all. So nanoscale chemical vapor deposition is possible using STM. So again, this was published in Science in 1993. So here what they have done is they have created various metallic nanoscale dots and line patterns on conducting substrates. So basically, using STM technique, they were able to create patterns, different types of patterns, at the atomic scale or nanoscale level using STM. Moving on, another major application is in catalysis research. So what do this picture show? So this nickel gold catalyst has been used in steam reforming. So steam reforming, nothing but hydrocarbon, you treat, you generate hydrogen. So what this is, nickel ion catalyst is used for this steam reforming. But the practical difficulty of having a nickel and copper catalyst together is that nickel and alloy are immiscible in the bulk system. And in the bulk, you cannot be making a binary alloy. So they have achieved this binary alloy formation using STM. So what they have done is they mixed a few percentage of gold to nickel, and they annealed it at 800 Kelvin. Then they analyzed the surface of nickel, and they have found that binary alloys is being formed. So how did they confirm this? For example, the image A shows image of nickel surface with 2% of gold. So depending on the electron density of gold and nickel is different, you can see brighter spots which corresponds to that of gold, whereas the other ones corresponds to that of nickel. So as they increased the dosage or the level of gold to 7%, they could see that more and more nickel got substituted by gold atoms. So again, at an atomic level, they proved that binary alloy formation is possible. In spite of saying all these things, there are certain limitations for STM. Basically, the use of STM is confined to only research laboratories. What is the reason for that? Because you cannot be extending it to practical applications or onto a larger scale surfaces. So typically, the use of STM is confined to only labs where they deal with the fundamental problems of surfaces, but it will definitely help you to address many problems or you to understand many issues at the nanoscale level. Moreover, you need to have ultra high vacuum conditions and stringent monitoring of other conditions such as minimal sound interferences, similarly low temperature. Those are certain practical limitations of using STM in common kind of applications. Then moving on, I'll be discussing briefly about atomic force microscopy also. So basically, atomic force microscopy is also a scanning probe microscope technique where you can examine the surface topography. Also, you can do compositional mapping of heterogeneous samples. Similarly, you can study local mechanical, electrical, or magnetic properties. So, what is the basic working principle of atomic force microscopy or AFM is that in the case of STM, we were making use of the scanning, the quantum mechanical tunneling current. Whereas in this case, the mechanical force interaction between a sharp tip and the sample is used for surface imaging. So how do this thing work? In the case of AFM also, you have a sharp tip, but not a single atom sharp tip and all. You have a cantilever, a micro-machined cantilever, onto which a sharp tip will be attached. And this will be brought into contact with the sample surface. So what will happen? How do you measure the mechanical force of interactions? You will have a laser beam which is deflected onto the cantilever. So depending on the surface irregularities, your cantilever will be oscillating, and that oscillation will be reflected by the laser beam, and that laser beam will be directed onto a four segment photo detector. So this is used for measuring normal actions of the cantilever. So based on these deflections only, you will be imaging the surface. So moving on, this is how again, this is the working principle of AFM, which I'll be explaining as we move on. So basically here also you have your piezo drives onto which the cantilever will be attached, and also you will have a feedback control applied during imaging, which will ensure that your tip sample force is preserved at a constant level. If your tip sample force is not preserved at a constant level, you will not get any images. So this picture shows like how the cantilever deflection will be varying. This particular surface has a different morphology it has a different morphology at this particular point. So when the cantilever with the tip moves across the surface, when it reaches this particular position, the deflection is different. So that deflection is something what your laser beam will be detecting, and you will be getting an image. So what are the forces essentially experienced by a tip in AFM is van der Waals forces, surface tension, electrostatic force, or even chemical force. And in this case also, how do AFM works or this cantilever works? This cantilever basically acts like a spring for you. So if the spring constant of your cantilever is less than that of the sample surface, what will happen? It will bend, and then you will have a deflection. So depending on the mode of operation, the cantilever you choose will also be different. you have three modes of AFM operation. One is contact mode, second one is tapping mode, and third one is non-contact mode. So as the name suggests, contact mode is nothing but the tip will be making a very soft physical touch, physical contact with your sample surface. And the deflection of the lever based on the surface topography will be measured. So this again can be done in a constant height mode or a constant force mode, something similar which we have discussed in STM. So the tip used for contact mode is different. You should have a tip or a cantilever which has a very small spring constant and a very high resonance frequency. If the resonance frequency is very poor, maybe the deflections will not be measured accurately and hence you may not get a good clarity picture. And the most commonly used mode of operation of AFM is that of tapping mode. So as I said, tapping mode, this is something like the tap, the tip will be making intermittent contact with the sample surface. So the cantilever will be oscillating, and then the force that acts between your tip and the sample, depending on the surface topography, will cause a change in the amplitude of oscillation of your cantilever, which will be measured. And one advantage of using tapping mode is that since it only intermittently comes into contact with your sample surface, you will have very less damage to the surface. Whereas in the case of contact mode, the tip makes regular physical contact with the sample. So possibilities of the sample getting damaged is high in the case of contact mode. And non-contact mode is something where the tip-sample interaction is very minimized. So as I have shown earlier, this non-contact mode mostly happens in the attractive force region where the tip-sample distance is relatively high than that of the contact or the tapping mode of operation. Moving on, there are certain, again, prerequisites to get good images. Your specimen choice is something. So typically, if you use AFM, you can measure a 100 into 100 micron level magnification. The lowest magnification you can get is 100 into 100 microns. And typically, most of the AFMs will have a scanning sample size of around 1 into 1 centimeter, and the sample thickness should be of approximately 3 mm. Moving on, I talked about the basic principles of AFM, but for a layman, image artifact as well as real imaging, those two we should be able to distinguish image artifacts as well. So in AFM, image artifacts formation is quite common. So that is mainly because of two reasons. One is because of tip convolution. So what is tip convolution? You have an obstacle or something or a feature to be observed or imaged on a substrate, but your AFM tip, the radius of curvature of your AFM tip is so big, then what will happen is while you scan the surface, you end up in getting an artifact. Similarly, distortion of the image can happen because of change in the temperature of the probe sample environment. So these are the possible reasons for image artifacts in AFM. Moving on, these are some of the images which I have captured while learning the operations of AFM. So initially, I was thinking that, okay, I was able to capture some really good images. But when I analyzed the images, or I took the help of my mentor to analyze the images, it was found that all these images were basically artifacts. Those were not the real things which I should be measuring. So basically, these things happen because of two things. One, because of the scanner artifacts, such as non-linearity, scanner creep, and so on. And main reason for most of the image artifacts is your tip, the tip or the cantilever with the tip which you are using, because mostly for tapping mode and all, you will be using the same tip for analyzing various substrates. So repeated usage might lead to a worn tip, as well as sometimes a tip contamination can happen, and in some cases double tip can also do. So what will happen if you have double tip, the image you will be getting will be something like this. You will have a real image, along with that you will have an additional image. If you are not very sure about the image, you will think that okay, the image is quite nice, but really these are not real images, all these images are artifacts. Similarly, like, you will all be wondering, how do you measure it. How do you image it? So basically, this is how a cantilever will be looking like. Beneath this cantilever, you have the sharp tip, which is in contact with your sample surface. So in this case, this is the sample surface. This is the cantilever. Underneath, you have the sharp tip. So in this case, the laser should be aligned properly onto the cantilever. If not, what will happen? The deflection of the cantilever will not be detected properly by the photo detector, and hence you will not have a real image. So how do you know that my laser beam, the laser beam is exactly aligned onto the cantilever? By seeing the sum signal, you can make sure that yes, the laser signal is exactly on the top of the cantilever. And how do you, what are the parameters which you need to optimize during imaging is adjustment of your scan rate, gain, set points, and so on. So this is how, this is actually a standard substrate which we image to see whether the conditions are all right for imaging. So this is a standard sample. So the first image in this case is not very bad, but exactly this is not what we want. The image should be looking like the second one. Why? Because here you can see that there is some drift happening, some line formations and so on. So you should be optimizing these scan rate, which is basically the speed at which your tip will be scanning your sample surface, and gains are something which will be improving the amount of your input signal. So if you optimize all these parameters, you are sure to get a very good image. So after optimizing all those parameters, you will be getting the image of the standard, something like this, where you will be able to measure the, so this is how your height profiling will be. So this is actually a grid kind of a thing. So you have some depths in it. So you can actually measure the thickness using this height profiling also. I'll show you that in subsequent images. Moving on, there are different secondary AFM imaging modes. So basically, I will not be describing or explaining too much about them. The first one is lateral force microscopy. So here, this is a contact AFM mode. So basically, the difference in the frictional force between the probe tip and the sample surface is something you are imaging. So here, the major application is in identifying transitions between different components in a polymer blend, because the frictional force between one particular component in a polymer blend and the other component will be different. So ideally, you can identify these transitions. Similarly, you will be able to identify contaminants also on different type of substrates. So these are the applications of lateral force microscopy. Moving on, the next one is phase imaging, which is also a tapping mode of operation. So basically, from the image, this image, you can clearly understand what is phase imaging. So the first one is topography image, or a normal image of a silicon hydrogel in a saline solution. And the second one is a phase image. So phase image will help you to find different components in a composite material. So in simple words, by seeing the variation in the contrast of the image, you can understand that you have different components in that material, and it will differentiate regions of high and low surface adhesion, hardness, or different regions with different electrical or magnetic properties and so on. So phase imaging is also a very useful mode of operating AFM. And the third one is magnetic force microscopy. So here, instead of the mechanical forces, here you are seeing the change in the cantilever's amplitude and resonance frequency, or change in the cantilever's oscillation based on the magnetic field dependence. So here, using magnetic force microscopy, you can image any naturally occurring or any deliberately created magnetic domains. So these are some secondary modes of operation of AFM. And one more mode is there, which is conductive AFM. So from the term itself, this is basically characterizes conductivity variation across medium. So this mode is also effectively used to understand the conductivity variations across different regions. So moving on. Again, I would like to see how I would like you guys to see how I have how I have made use of AFM to analyze some of my samples. So again, the left hand side image shows the AFM image of graphene flakes deposited on mica substrate. So other microscopic tools such as optical microscopy or electron microscopy will also give you morphological analysis. But one more advantage of using AFM is that high profiling is possible. So with a transmission electron microscopic image or a TEM image of a graphene flake, I will not be able to say what is the thickness of the graphene sheet which I have observed, which I have got. But in this case, using AFM, I could clearly find out what is the thickness of the flake which I have got. Similarly, this is an entirely different type of study where we had investigated the structural damage in human erythrocytes when you expose it to different types of nanoparticles. In this work, I had collaborated with one of my colleagues. So basically, she was trying to understand the level of toxicity of silver, gold, and platinum nanoparticles on RBCs, red blood cells. So the first image in this picture shows untreated red blood cells where you have a biconcave shape which is intact. And the second image shows treated RBCs with silver nanoparticles at a lower concentration. So the C and D is further higher concentrations of silver nanoparticles. So D is basically RBCs treated with 400 micrograms of silver nanoparticles. So you can clearly see that as the concentration of silver nanoparticle increases, the surface of your RBCs are getting damaged. The biconcave shape which you see in a normal RBC is getting ruptured, and as you move on or as you increase the concentration of silver nanoparticle, the damage is much more, and basically the structure is completely lost. The RBC structure is completely lost when you use 400 micrograms of sample. Whereas when they used gold and platinum, when we used gold and platinum under the same condition, not much of deformities was observed. So based on this structural topographical analysis, we could find that among silver, gold, and platinum, basically silver nanoparticle is something which causes excessive damage to human erythrocytes, whereas gold and platinum doesn't cause damage to that. So if you use other characterization tools, yes, you can see the damages happening, but not at the intrinsic level where you can see the details like what is happening exactly. SEM image will also give you an idea when the RBCs get ruptured and all, but what is exactly happening like on a concentration dependent was possible when we were imaging individual RBCs using AFM. So these were some of the studies done from our group itself, and now I will just summarize what are the uses of AFM. So as I said earlier, you can use it for substrate roughness analysis. Second one is morphology analysis, or in simple way, grain size analysis. And one interesting aspect or use of AFM is AFM-based lithography. So lithography is something which you are grafting onto the surface. So there are three major types of lithography, AFM-based lithography. First one is thermomechanical, where you use a heated AFM tip to construct the patterns on the surface. The next one is dip pen lithography. So as the name suggests, this is something like the AFM tip is used to deliver some molecules onto the sample surface in a solvent meniscus. So this is something like you are depositing an ink onto the surface, and again you are generating a pattern. And the last one is biased probe lithography, where an AFM tip is biased and you have a high localized electric field generated on the tip or in between the substrate and the tip, which will lead to formation of patterns on different substrates. Again, I would like to show some of, this is not my work, actually my colleague had done this. So this is biased probe lithography on PMMA film, polymethacrylate film. So here what they have done is by using biased probe lithography, they have created different types of patterns and pits on the surface at again micrometer level. Similarly, electropolymerization was also achieved using AFM. So here what they have done is they deposited a monomeric film of carbazole, and with the help of AFM tip, they had patterned this writing of NUS, and this was the first time. Normally what will happen is if you heat the substrate, the written text will be lost, but here they were able to form a very temperature stable. So this image actually shows when they heat it at 270 degrees Celsius for 3 hours, even then the polymerization that had happened and the patterning which was formed did not get damaged or deteriorated. So these are some applications of AFM which my lab in NUS were working on. So that's all for today. I would like to thank my PhD supervisor, Dr. Suresh Valiyavittil, and my whole lab members, because most of these techniques I learned during my the time which I spent in NUS. So I would like to acknowledge them first. Yeah, that's all. Now, if you have any questions, please.
So thank you, Sajni, for a nice presentation. Then there are certain doubts which I noted in the chat box. First one. So any participants, you can directly interact with her after this. First from a Praveen Prakash, sir. Okay. That is, which non-covalent interaction acts in between graphene and alkyl azides?
One more time.
Which non-covalent interaction acts in...
Okay, I got it. It's basically not a non-covalent interaction. We were trying to functionalize the edges of graphene or the C double bond C with azide chemistry. So basically, we were trying to do a covalent functionalization in that system. It was not non-covalent interaction.
And another question from Sudeep Datta, that is any calibration required for an instrument? That is, yes. How calibration can be measured?
Yes, if you see any of these microscopic instruments, they will give you a calibration kit, which periodically you should be calibrating the instrument. If not, as I said earlier, you might be getting artifacts, but you will assume that those are your sample surfaces. So calibration with some standard is always required. So definitely they will be providing you a manual how to calibrate the instrument. So you'll have to follow that periodically. Yes.
Sajni, please switch on your camera so that we can.
Okay. Okay, fine.
There was one question. That is, how we can calculate the roughness factor for a material using AFM?
Yeah, so as I said, you can get the high profiling of the substrate, and then the software itself will give you an analysis of the roughness of the substrate. So depending on the area you are scanning, you can get an average, and so you will be able to find the roughness. So basically that software itself will give you how do you calculate the roughness.
So, participants, you are free to ask any questions. So, anybody want to interact with Sajni, madam? Please, you can have this time. Okay, we are very happy to have a resource person from an industrial area. So please, Sajni, can you share some of your experiences in Kevin Care?
Yeah, definitely. So currently I work in Kevin Care, which is an FMCG company, Indian FMCG company, which is nearly 30 years old. So we basically venture into foods, dairy, snacks, and personal care products. So basically, I work in the personal care regime where we develop skin and hair cosmetics, basically shampoos, hair colors, skin creams, and so on. So my role in Kevin Care is to develop innovative products for hair coloring. I work in the hair colors department as of now. And moreover, my responsibilities lies with intellectual property rights, because basic research groups work on some IP protection. So most of those things we should be translating it into product. And So my role is that, my job responsibility is that in Kevin Care. And see, industry works in a very different way. The pressure on you will be always quite high because you are supposed to deliver the results in stipulated time manner. You will have extensive pressure from different teams to launch the product on time if you are in product development. So working in academics and industry is quite a different experience. I can't actually compare both of them. Yes.
Sachini ma'am, please, we can wait for some time. There are more questions in the YouTube.
Sure.
Is one question, that is, what makes the current lesser tips which are not sharp?
See, that is what I had explained earlier. If the tip is not very sharp, you will have maybe 2 to 3 atoms which is sitting on the tip surface. So what will happen is the tunneling current, the intensity or the measure of tunneling current from a single atom will be much more higher than what you see from a blunt tip. And similarly, a blunt tip cannot be brought into very close proximity to a single atom on the surface. Basically, if you have a blunt object, it will be touching more surface area. So basically, you will not be able to have a clear atomic resolution if you use a blunt tip. That is the basic reason why we insist that the tip should be as sharp as possible.
Which is more good for imaging, AFM or STM?
It will depend on what kind of applications you are looking at. So AFM is typically something which you can use for large area image scanning, and as you asked, like, you can measure roughness and so on. But STM is a bit more advanced where you can have atomic level of imaging. So yeah, that is basically the difference between these two.
So anybody, you can ask any doubts. I think the presentation was very nice with more images, good images.
Thank you.
So, Emuna, please.
Yeah. Thank you, Bashpa. And thank you, Dr. Sajani, for this wonderful, nice presentation.
Thank you.
Actually,
so
it was great. This precise and...
There's one more doubt, I think, from Sudeep Datta. How graph is plotted in this?
Which graph? I'm not clear. Like, what type?
Sir, Sudeep Datta, sir. The question was only how graph is plotted. Oh, nice. Our resource person, Dr. Preetam Bradwaj, is here. And there is one question from him. How can I measure the thickness of a thin film by scanning probe microscope?
Okay, so basically AFM can be used to measure the thickness of a thin film. So what you have to do is you will have to take the edge of the thin film onto the substrate. Like if it is a very uniform thin film, you will have to create some groove onto it. And then if you analyze the substrate and the depth in which the groove has been formed can be used as a tool to measure your thickness of the thin film.
Okay, sir. Sudeep Datta, sorry, sir. I mean, in which software we are plotting the graph?
Which graph? The height profiling and all will come automatically along with the image. So you need not have any separate software to plot the graphs. And if you are asking me, you can use Origin software to plot other graphs other than Excel. Yes, you can use Origin. I'm not very sure whether he asked this or something else.
Sir, you can directly interact with. So you can directly ask. He's specifically asking about Subarna Roy, ma'am. That is, if manipulation mode is there, then original result may be manipulated. What is the requirement for that particular mode? Slide 11, specifically saying.
Okay, so basically manipulation mode is not to manipulate the results which you get. It's basically, it's a basic type of research where you want to manipulate the surface by displacing one particular atom, say from one location to the other, and then study the properties and so on. So that is what I meant by manipulation mode. It is not to manipulate the original results.
Another question from Preetham sir. That is, what is meant by set point and integral gain in scanning probe microscopy?
Okay, so in AFM, when you scan a sample surface, you need to set your set point and integral gain to an optimal level. If you don't set this integral gain and set point to the right levels, what you will have is you will have some drift in the imaging. So basically, these are some parameters like scan rate and it's the sum signal which I was saying, how the laser beam should be correctly aligned onto the cantilever. The set point and integral gain is also a part of optimizing the conditions for imaging in AFM.
So a question from Yamina ma'am, that is, did you try to relocate the same images under AFM?
See, SEM images are mainly in micrometer level. Yes, we can see similar images in AFM also, because it is also a two-dimensional way. And one advantage with AFM is that you can make it three-dimensional, as I have shown in the RBC thing. Actually, that those images were taken in the 2D manner, but we had converted it into the 3D format so that we could clearly see the biconcave nature and all. So, and basically SEM image, you scan a larger area, whereas in AFM, the area you scan is very small. So exactly relocating will be difficult, but it is not impossible. Yes, we can do.
Okay. Can STM and AFM can be used to visualize the surface of enzymes?
STM will be very difficult because you need to have ultra high vacuum conditions and so on. So if you maintain ultra high vacuum, I don't know whether the properties or the nature of the enzyme will remain intact. In liquid mode, there are some advanced STMs where you can study biological samples also, but I'm not very sure about it.
So thank you, Sajni, for a nice discussion with us.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
Yamina, so, you can link and...
Okay. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Sajni for this wonderful, nice, crisp presentation. It was really great, actually. And thank you for receiving our invitation and joining us. And also, the audience, the participants, they raised a lot of points of discussion, and the discussion session was also very active and lively. And I thank the participants for that too. And so, friends, with this, we are closing the second session of our webinar series, and we will meet next week with a new resource question. And I hope to meet you all there in the next Saturday, again at 2 p.m. in the same platform. And thank you all once again, and especially Dr. Sajni. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much. Bye. Bye.